commemoration of your life-giving cross. The Church petitioned you through the mouths of her children with the fragrance of this incense. As in the beginning you know you created all of the blood of love, then return to save and give new life. Now grant your mercy upon us, the work of your creation. By your cross grant peace to the whole universe. By your cross remove anger and put an end to all wars. By your cross eliminate all dissension. By your cross curb violence and pacify the angry. By your cross humble the proud, expose the self-serving, and remove the enemy. By your cross, establish your church in strength, and make her monasteries and convents firm. By your cross, purify your priests and exalt your deacons. By your cross, sustain the elderly, subdue the haste of youth, and educate the young. By your cross, pardon sinners, forgive wrongdoers, and guard your flock which now worships you. Honors your passion, embraces your wounds, and is glorified and exalted by your crucifixion. Save us and save all your people. Completely perfect us in your strength. Visit us and revive us so that our image may be renewed and our likeness recover. May your comfort take away the sadness of our hearts, and your compassion dry our tears. Then we shall wear your glory and be clothed in your light. Make us worthy to meet the day of your resurrection as heirs of the kingdom. Then without ceasing we shall raise glory to you now and forever.
Endure pain.
On this day, the Son of Justice, prepared.
in our effort to be justified in Christ, we ourselves have been found to be sinners. Is Christ then a servant of sin? Certainly not. But if I build up again the very things that I once tore down, then I demonstrate that I am a transgressor. For though the law died to the law so that I might live to God, I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if justification comes through the law, then Christ died for nothing. You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? It was before your eyes that Jesus Christ was publicly exhibited as crucified. The only thing I want to learn from you is this. Did you receive the Spirit by doing the works of the law or by believing in what you heard? Are you foolish? Having started with the Spirit, are you now ending with the flesh? Did you experience so much for nothing? If it really was for nothing, does God supply you with the Spirit and work miracles among you by your doing works of the law, or by you believing in what you heard? Just as Abraham believed God, it was reckoned to him as righteousness. So, you see, those who believe are the descendants of Abraham. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify Gentiles by faith, declared the gospel before to Abraham, saying, all the Gentiles shall be blessed in you. For this reason, those who believe are blessed with Abraham. For all who rely on the words of the law are under a curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone who does not observe and obey all things written in the book of law. Now it is evident that no one is justified before God by the law. For the one who is righteous will live by faith. But the law does not rest on faith. On the contrary, whoever does the works of the law will live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree, in order that Christ Jesus, the blessing of Abraham, might come to the Gentiles, so that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Praise be to God always. Amen. Exalt the Lord before our God. Bow down before his footstool.
When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. And they cast lots to divide his clothing, and the people stood by watching. But the leaders scoffed at him, saying, he saved others, let him save himself if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one. The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, if you are the King of the Jews, save yourself. There was also an inscription over him, this is the King of the Jews. One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us. But the other rebuked him, saying, do you not fear God? Since you are under the same sentence of condemnation, and we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And he replied, Amen, I say to you, today you shall be with me in paradise. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother, and his mother's sister Mary of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, Woman, behold your son. Then he said to the disciple, Behold your mother. And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, I am thirsty. A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, It is finished. Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. As we've gone through this Passion Week, we've considered back and forth between what our Lord is accomplishing, but especially we've looked at the position of the people around our Lord. And focusing actually many times on the Mother of God herself, that act of faith, which gave her the great stability and strength throughout this whole week of humiliation and strife, and of course pain and suffering and seeing the unjust death of her son. So what is the Christ, what is the Messiah doing in these days? He's sinless, and therefore death has no hold on him whatsoever. But he chooses, as we've mentioned, to freely embrace death. Because what takes place within the human race since the time of Adam and Eve is a division that runs through each of our hearts. There is a division which always moves toward good, our better side, or what is often referred to as the better angels of our nature. But there is also a side which is always there at the same time, which is always very self-centered. We judge things constantly, and that division moves us back and forth. I don't think that any of us think we are the real persons that we would like to be. We may be okay. Some of us may think we're actually pretty good. But even the people who think that they're pretty good could probably see something better if they really stopped and thought for a moment. Because of course, only the damned think they're perfect and fine. But that is a sign of perdition. That division through the heart is in the parable when our Lord gives, speaking about the strong man and the stronger man. And that how when the strong man is holding his place, then when the strong man, he's secure until the stronger man comes and despoils him and distributes the booty. It's a very strange parable. But the parable is immediately followed by a man being possessed and the devil being cast out, wandering through the desert, grumbling unto himself, this is horrible, I gotta go back to where I was. And when he returns, he finds, as our Lord tells us in the parable, the place swept and clean, but it's empty. And that demon, we are told, take seven others with him, and he returns to that man, and the man's state is worse than it was at the beginning. Our Lord, through these parables, is talking about the division that runs through the center of all of us, that tug between our own self-centeredness and what we were created for, which is the divine light. And that tug, precisely, is within human nature. What our Lord does freely is to embrace our human chaos. His desire not only is to embrace death, that signal collapse of the presence of sin in the world. And God said in paradise, if you partake of this tree, you will certainly die the death. You will die the death. The Hebraic way, the Semitic way of saying, it is absolutely certain that you will die. And the first lie that is uttered is when the serpent speaking to Eve, and she says to the serpent, we're not supposed to partake of this tree, because perhaps we may die. God told them in no uncertain terms, you make this movement in that direction and you will die. So what our Lord embraces is he embraces not only death as that signal grace, is he also embraces that inner chaos that runs through each of us. And that chaos is what then becomes manifest during this week of betrayal and of hardship and injustice and death and humiliation. And that is why when St. Paul is quoting from the Old Testament in the reading that we have this evening, cursed is the one who hangs upon the cross. And what our Lord, what St. Paul is doing then is showing us the indication that what our Lord is embracing is that division that runs through the human heart. And if the human heart is where the demon has that ability, those parables, that our Lord, in embracing that human nature, sinless as he is personally, embraces all of that turmoil, anxiety, anxiousness, anger, and self-centeredness, which makes up all of the effects of original sin, and so often is the cause of even further sins. And so what our Lord is doing is embracing the very terrain. You fight militarily, you don't fight like the war in Kuwait, where you stop at the border and don't finish the job. You head for the capital and you destroy the government. And then you're victorious. Where is the battle of sin waged? It's not outside us. It's not with some mysterious force outside of us. It's here, within human nature. Which is why God himself chose to embrace that human nature, enter into it, and freely take upon himself that terrain. And that is why the parable talks about the strong man. The strong man in the parable is the demon, who since the time of the expulsion from paradise was quite secure and quite content. But our Lord says in the parable, until the stronger man comes, lays waste to his terrain, and then distributes the spoils. The stronger man is the Lord Jesus. The stronger man is the Messiah. And his coming is to embrace within that terrain of the human heart, which violates creation, and you read the beautiful center of this evening, that choice that our parents made in the beginning, and that act of violence that they effected upon human nature, that was created in beauty and light and divine charity and love. And they violated it in the very beginning because of what they decided would be right and wrong. And that violation was an act of violence because they felt in no way tugged toward it. For us, we always feel tugged in all kinds of directions. Things that we know we're supposed to be doing isn't usually what tugs us. Other stuff does. Lower stuff. Things that are easier to get. But with Adam and Eve, there was no inclination. They had to commit an act of violence upon their nature to make the choices that they made. And so when our Lord embraces that terrain, what we see through the passion is a manifestation precisely of the turmoil that goes on within the human heart. Which is why then when our Lord goes to his death in full embrace out of love for his Father and love for the human race, he winds up allowing himself to be nailed to that tree, nailed to that cross, so that all of that turmoil, as St. Paul quotes from the Torah, will be accursed. Cursed is the one who hangs upon the tree. And so what our Lord does is he takes that human nature and he allows it in all of the anxiety and turmoil in which, as we mentioned last night, the devil thinks he's got rid of this pesky rabbit. But it becomes the very moment by which our Lord turns the whole thing upon its head. And so what he does when he allows his nature, he allows himself to be beaten and spit upon and humiliated and scourged and then nailed to the cross, he is allowing that human nature to be shredded, quite literally, by the scourging and everything else that he goes through, which hopefully you've read through the Passion this week. And that scourging is the rending of his human nature, is the rending of his flesh, that St. Paul in the letter to the Hebrews will say that we have a living veil. So that when you read the Gospels and we know that the holy place in the temple and the Holy of Holies where the Ark of the Covenant was, that at the moment of our Lord's death, that the veil which separated those two rooms within the temple was torn from the top down, not from the bottom up, not done by human hands, but torn from the top down, signifying the opening to the place of God, which was symbolized by that place where the Ark of the Covenant was held. But why is it being torn? Because the very human flesh of God himself on Calvary at that same moment is being torn asunder in death, is being nailed to this cross. And that human nature which is being torn, as we saw last night, is transformed into that divine Eucharist before which we stand in awe. And the majesty for which we render nothing but gratitude and thanks for all that he has done for us. And it's this reason why when St. Paul writes to the Hebrews, he says that we have a living veil through which we access to the Holy of Holies, that is, his flesh. The veil rendered in the temple is only symbolic of what is taking place at Calvary in that same city of God in Jerusalem, outside the gates, inside the gates. So when we come up to adore our Lord's cross after the procession, and after the procession, it's not very pleasant outside, so this year we'll still be inside. But as we make our three times around and the men who will hold our Lord, it will be in the back. And as you pass in to go back to your places, of course, we duck under. We duck under because freely we desire also to enter that tomb with our Lord. We desire to be identified with him so that the same identity and recognition of that rending of his nature upon Calvary that we desire to enter through that living veil, so that then we can participate in that glorious resurrection. And after we are done, we will do the three times the metani, to go down on all fours, hands and knees. And after the priests and the clergy have venerated, adored the cross, as each one comes up, make that profound bow. You can go down on all fours if you want. That is the ancient tradition. And the Latin rite traditionally, they took off their shoes and entered head uncovered and everything, so. But at least the profound bow from the waist, kneel down on the bima and venerate that dead image of our Lord, because we know that it is the movement toward life. That it condemns within my life that pettiness, that selfishness, that self-centeredness, that anger, that avarice, and that fear of death that inspires so much of what we do throughout our days. And that when we kiss the feet of our Lord's body, we desire to embrace that death so that life may be given to us. When we do this, We've come to understand both what does it mean to say that cursed is the one who dies upon the cross, but also the fact that our Lord, I'll leave you with a quote from St. Ephrem, that our Lord in speaking about our Lord's, St. Ephrem in speaking about our Lord's death says that the slain one, provided from his own blood, remember St. John, the blood and water that come forth, provided from his own blood the water wherewith his slayers might wash clean and themselves find life. This is the adoration we render this night. May our Lord make it fruitful in our lives, each personally. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Jesus Christ our Lord, the Son of God, O crucified one, lifted high on the cross, you raised up creation to its wondrous Creator on high. We call out to you in prayer, O Lord, hear us. Jesus Christ our Lord, the Son of God, you were stripped and nailed to the wood of shame, that we may be clothed with glory and victory. We call out to you in prayer, O Lord, hear us.
Gentlemen, the gentlemen who have been doing the shrouds. Jesus, we worship you, for you have filled the whole world with the fragrance of your incense. Your pure cross is a spiritual censer in creation, has been reconciled to your Father by its fragrant smoke. But in place of a fiery coal, there is your blood, and rather than fragrant smoke, there is your love. The smoke which rose from your cross was offered to your Father for the priesthood of your human nature. Now accept this incense from an unworthy hand. Grant forgiveness to all your flock in eternal rest, to the faithful departed, now and forever.
Bye. peace.